everybody. Today I'm here with Corey Lee Barker. He is a songwriter and a professional coffee drinker.
Movie Making with Renelle Golden is brought to you by Samira Entertainment, supporting indie films and the filmmakers who create them. Stop by their website to learn more, www.samiraentertainment.com. That's www.samiraentertainment.com.
How are you doing?
Doing well. This is actually hot tea right now, but don't tell anybody because coffee's
used. Oh, you're drinking tea? Oh my God, you crossed over. You know, I've never had coffee in my life.
What?
And I really need to, I think. I drink tea like there's no tomorrow though. I don't know. I don't know why. It's kind of weird, but I figure coffee is like a crossroads to something else for me because I used to be like a Diet Coke addict.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the kind you drink, you know? So I'm like, I better not give in to my addictive personality. So no, but anyway, we're here to talk about songwriting and music and, you know, music placement and all that good stuff. But let's go way back, not way back. You're not that old. Let's go back to the beginning. How did you get the music bug?
You know, I think at an early age, I used to love to make fun of everybody else's songs. like Weird Al Yankovic, you know, it has made a perfect living doing that. And I think that,
oh my God.
I used to love to do parodies and sing the wrong words. And then it kind of made me look at structure and learn it more and then started to take it seriously.
How old were you? Like middle school or pretty young?
Oh, as soon as I could write, I was either writing short stories or writing silly songs or making
fun of everybody. Love that. Oh, that's so funny. Oh my God. So fast forward, you actually started seriously writing music then. When did that happen?
When I was 13, I remember writing my first serious song, and then I moved to Nashville in 1998 and have been on, you know, 400 or 500 song a year pace since then.
Wow.
I don't even know what I wrote yesterday. I couldn't tell you the words to any of them, but.
Oh, I love that. That's so funny. Did you ever, or maybe you still do, did you ever try the route, like, I'm going to have a band and I'm going to tour, and or were you like writing songs is where it was at for you?
You know, funny enough, the first year, I think I played 100 and some odd shows as an artist. And I actually got fired from a place that I was singing for free. And that's a real confidence booster right there.
Talent there, right? Oh, my God. That's so, what was happening to me.
But it made me realize that there were so many more opportunities for other artists and other TV shows and other movies. It's just infinite.
You know,
the last I heard, there were over 8 million opportunities every year to put your song in TV, film, commercial, video game, visual.
Oh, wow. Wow.
That's a lot of opportunity. Whereas being an artist, you've got one chance and that's you.
Yeah, it's true. It is true. I grew up in the music industry, so I know the kind of the rejection or heartache or the blood, sweat, and tears. I don't even know the words to describe it. It's unique when you're in that performing on stage kind of level. It's very, is vulnerable the right word? I don't know.
It's all that. I mean, you're definitely putting yourself out there, especially if you're speaking stories that you actually experienced. They assume you experienced them anyway.
You do, actually. It's part of living, right? Growing up, which maybe sucks or is wonderful. Who knows? So you wrote your first song to get placed somewhere. How did you cross over that bridge where you were writing music that could, you know, get placed in commercials or TV shows? Or how did you cross that bridge?
My original goal moving down here was to just write for artists. I didn't really think about TV and film and sync.
Oh.
And then a really good artist I was writing with, his wife was connected with someone who was a sync agent and was working on our favorite TV show, Smallville, at the time in 2000.
Oh, wow.
And got them the song, and we waited 6 months for any kind of response, and they said, you might want to turn your TV on Thursday night and see your song. Wow. We were just so crazy.
Oh, my God, that's cool. That is cool. When you started writing for artists, how did you reach them? Did you need a manager, or were you able to just kind of like reach out and say, hey, listen to these songs? How does it work?
There's pitch sheets that are available to you that you can subscribe to. That's in Nashville anyway, not necessarily in the pop or the R&B world, but for country music, for instance.
Oh,
there's a pitch sheet called rofax.com. There's a website and you can sign up and maybe $200 a year. And weekly, they will send you all the artists who have listed on there looking for songs and what tempo, all this kind of stuff.
Rofax.com.
So you have an insight. Now, the problem is all the major artists, they'll tell you they're looking, but they're not going to give you any kind of contact.
So
you learn over the years that you need to be in the room with the artist in the trenches creating to be part of their project. So that's what I've done the last couple decades, is I put myself in the room with the artist, and they're more likely to want to record something that they were a part of, because they get
a big part of what you do then for your success. Because I mean, oh my God, you've had over 1,200 songs that have been, you know, recorded and placed and put into like all the major networks. So your big job for you, besides writing the music, is being your own advocate, your own marketing, and getting out there and getting in front of people that rest on you. That's probably a daily part of your life then.
It's all about, talent is that much of it.
You know, just a little bit.
It's working those contacts, making new contacts, treating those people good so they want to come back to you when you do make those contacts.
Oh, wow. It's
pretty exhausting being, you know, wearing all the hats, but if you don't do it, nobody's going to do it for you.
Right. Before we get into Christmas, what are some stories you thought maybe this wouldn't happen? And then you're like, oh my God, this guy recorded my song. Or what's some prideful moments, exciting moments?
You know, there's tons of those. One that comes to mind, I had a publisher, I pitched a song that I demoed. And, you know, as writers, we have to demo the songs for presentation. So you're looking at least $500 usually just to pitch the song.
Oh, my gosh.
There's no guarantee that anybody's ever going to take it. But, you know, with TV and film, you can't pitch it just a work tape. You have to have the full deal ready to
fully orchestrated and make it sound like the... Oh, interesting.
So,
wow.
In this one instance, this person told me that nobody's ever going to want to cut that because they wouldn't want to look at themselves like that. And I understood. And then 20 years later, believe it or not, William Shatner put it on his album. So,
oh my God, that's cool.
What do I know? What do they know? I don't know. It's really cool to hear Captain Kirk sing some songs.
Oh my God, that's actually really cool. Wow. Was that a holiday song?
So he teamed up with Jeff Cook from the group Alabama.
Oh, one of my favorites. Okay.
Oh, me too. And so basically William, he spoke the verses, and then Jeff Cook sang all the choruses, and they were a duo for this entire project.
Oh,
and
that's neat.
Their label called me, and they used 8 songs of mine. So I was a kid in a candy store on both accounts
because
I was in Alabama. Mm-hmm.
How many songs were on the album?
I think 10 or 11.
Wow. Oh, that's kind of cool. That's a total honor there. Very, very cool.
I felt selfish, but it was great.
Hey, I think it's cool. Yeah. So at one point, you became Christmas Corey. How did that happen? Do you know Santa?
I don't. It was so funny. For whatever reason, I was getting several Christmas songs cut every year.
Oh, wow.
And when I finally broke through to a Hallmark supervisor that was willing to listen to my songs, and they put a couple of them in there, and everybody around me in my network just thought that was the greatest thing since sliced bread, even though there's people with way more, you know, Hallmark placements than I had. But they started, you know, calling me Christmas Corey, and then it just started snowballing from there. I would get more the next year and more cuts the next year because the artist wanted to write with me in order to maybe get their songs in the TV show.
Oh. So
it was a snowball effect, and I think we have 6 movies this year with Christmas songs going in it already, and it's been wonderful.
Wow. I love that. Do you do the lyrics too? Or do you do the whole thing, or do you partner with lyricists, or how's that work?
Well, it's, I can do all those things. Lyrics are my strong suit and the titles, but it behooves me to have an artist in the room at all times, as we talked about before.
Right.
Both of these are collaborations, and the artists are hoping that their version will get in the movie. And so on since they're, you know, the financial behind the recording,
right,
it's up to me to try to help them get their song in the TV show. And I don't charge anything to do that. So it's kind of a win-win for both of us when those good things happen.
Oh, that is cool. So what's the process like then when you're doing a song that you know, the intention is to try to get it placed and you've met with an artist? Do you guys sit down and do like a brainstorming session, or where do you do the initial writing and then bring them in, or how does that work?
It's kind of different in each scenario. The first thing, we want to be true to the artist because they don't want to try to sing something that they would never sing on purpose and it doesn't fit their artistry.
Right.
Because they don't see through that. They can kind of see when you're not being authentic. But then we also have to know okay, what happens in a million different movies? So that if we do the subject matter and it doesn't land in this movie, it's going to have so many more opportunities because we were pretty broad.
Got you. And that's true. Like if you're doing a Christmas song too, there's a lot of places that I could go.
And Christmas, I'll tell you, with Christmas, it's a perfect example. There's two safe zones. If you're thinking, you know, Hallmark Lifetime kind of deal.
Yeah.
It's either you are my entire Christmas list. You're saying that in a different way and a little pep behind it. Up-tempo, jolly.
You're everything I want. Okay.
It's that, or it's, oh my gosh, Christmas is coming and it's here.
That childlike excitement.
That's 90% of your safe zone right there.
Are you serious?
If you're writing a song about Santa, none of the Hallmark movies are about Santa.
No. They're about love or the season. Wow.
So, okay. So we really have to think. We don't want to paint ourselves into a corner lyrically or title-wise.
Right.
Because we want to make sure it can be used in a whole bunch of different movies and not just pigeonhole to that one movie.
That's really good. That's interesting. I didn't know that. Do you prefer writing Christmas songs now, or is it just part of your wheelhouse? Is something you're very good at?
Well, it's not the only thing that I write, but it seems to be what I write. I probably write 180 Christmas songs a year now.
Oh my gosh.
But you kind of do what's working for you. If I'm having luck in that zone, why would I?
Yeah, don't break it. If it ain't, what's that saying? If it ain't broke,
don't fix it.
Thank you. That one. Yeah. Oh, that's so funny. How interesting. So, and your songs, the thing is, you're the songwriter, so you don't always get the accolades or you're not there for the awards, but your songs have done really well. Like you've had them on, you know, Billboard charts, Grammy winning albums. So how does that work for you as the songwriter?
It's always going to look a whole lot better on paper than it will in your bank account. I'll tell you that.
Okay. Yeah.
But it's been wonderful to watch all these good things happen. And it's great to be able to not only have good things happen for you, but you get to help other people with their dreams get higher up a chart or get in a movie they wouldn't have been in otherwise.
Yeah, I love that.
Great, warm and fuzzies, you know, all around.
Love that. Well, people like you inspire me because until I got married when I was like 28, I was always making music, college full-time job, working with the band, like, I just wanted to be a songwriter, but back in my day, God, I'm old. It's not like it is today. There was no YouTube. There weren't all these streaming platforms to put your music on. Like, it was harder. It was a little different. And I grew up, my mom was a professional musician that toured. Matter of fact, she was contracted with the Holiday Inns and she'd go around with her band to all their lounges up and down like the coast of Florida and stuff like that and perform. But it's so different now. And I've been getting inspired when I meet people like you. I'm like, ooh, could I write the lyrics at least to my music or something? To the music I'm going to put in my movies, which I love movie making more than I actually liked music making. It's kind of weird. But people like you, it's so amazing because you can pump out just so much. You're like constantly music's flowing from your being or something. It's cool.
I don't know where the off button is. Let's keep going.
Oh.
Where the coffee comes in, though.
You need the coffee. Yes. Yes. So do you end up are you there for the whole process? Do you end up in the recording studio with the people or playing on the albums or do you get to do that?
So I never play on the albums because I live in Nashville where the musicians are top of the top.
Oh, that's true.
So I don't have to worry about that.
Yeah.
I'm typically writing twice a day, every day with different groups of people, writers, producers, artists.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I can squeeze it to where I can cancel one of those and get to the session. I like to be there and see the magic happen because sometimes they need help with the phrasing to make sure that, you know, the inner rhymes come out right or however they
might not. That's very cool. Super cool.
Or other times I just have to wait and see what happens and then get an email and say, hey, the song's coming out Tuesday. Share it with your friends and that kind of thing. So.
Oh, gotcha. Gotcha. Have you passed this down to your kids or your family members? Or are you the only musician in the house?
They don't like to, they don't like the same kind of music that I do.
Sappy loves
it. Taking it easy then, or work hard kind of thing. You know?
Gotcha. Gotcha. That's funny. So what kind of advice would you share to for somebody wanting to get into songwriting, but not be a performer?
Mm-hmm. Well, are we talking for artists or for TV and film? Because there's two different
Okay. Let's do both. Let's say somebody wants to write for artists
I would suggest anybody who's wanting to write for artists to come spend some time in Nashville with the people who have been here for, you know, a decade or two, working with other people who have been here for a decade or two.
So and would that be like interning?
Information. Well, not interning. It's co-writing is the way that it's done. Nobody hardly writes songs by themselves anymore. You get in a room with one or two other people, sometimes three.
Oh, wow.
And brainstorming. And that way, your percentage of the song is going to be smaller, but you have four outlets to try to make something happen with that song. Because you have all those people working on it and all of their connections. And then, like we said, it costs money if you want to pitch to film to get the recording done. So that would be four people who could split the cost potentially if it wasn't an artist in the room doing it for their project. So
who Who do you pitch to actually place your music?
So I have a whole book on this. But imdbpro.com has been my best friend the last couple of years. I can look up movies that are in production, pre-production, regular production, post-production.
Okay.
Search by a keyword like Christmas, for instance, and all the movies that have Christmas in the title will pop up, or holiday, or if I'm wanting to do a spiritual thing, I would look up God or Jesus or holy, the word, one of those words,
and
that kind of thing, or sports, you know, football.
I
reach out, and then it's usually crickets. But occasionally they'll look and say, okay, well, he's got this many placements. He's probably going to know how to, he probably won't be wasting our time, or at least there's a chance he's not.
Oh yeah. We were excited when I met you. I'm like, oh my God, it's Corey Christmas or Christmas Corey or something like that. Because, you know, doing a Christmas movie to get somebody that knows Christmas music is, oh my God, it's a blessing. It's huge. So
it's a lot of fun for me. The problem is the ones that don't know me, a lot of times, you know, they've got the people that they're comfortable with and they have that 10-year relationship with. They know they can go to them and they know what metadata is and they've crossed their T's and dotted their I's.
Yeah.
A lot of people can say yes to a stranger to pitch you music, but they don't know how to do the metadata. You don't know where it came from. And they didn't ask the other co-writers if it was okay to pitch the song.
And
that could get you in trouble. So you have to know that it's a one-stop shop. And they're more comfortable when they see that in the email.
Yeah, that's a good point. And yeah, that metadata is really critical to you guys, you know, getting what you should get in the end. So I never thought about that with multiple writers. You might not know. And I guess if a writer comes and they are green, they need to know more than just writing songs. They need to understand the dynamics of the business of songwriting. And just like, you know, me being a writer, when I realized how much business there is to writing, I'm a filmmaker, right? I know it because I had a corporate career for years, but so many people, they don't understand that. And I guess that'd be something to share with upcoming songwriters to understand the business, to make sure you read those contracts and metadata. I never would have thought of that 10 years ago. Meta what?
Well, exactly. Because here's where metadata comes in on the front end. Let's say I sent you a song and you really loved it. But you didn't have a movie going on right now. You just saved it in your iTunes.
Yep.
And a year or two from now, you're doing a movie and that song's perfect for it. And you click on it to see who sent that to you. And there's no metadata there. You don't even know where it came from.
Yeah.
I've had that happen.
Yeah. It's like in casting, I get these really amazing, talented people and they send in video auditions. We do that and then we'll do live and then chemistry or whatever. But they don't put their name in the file, right? They don't slate in the video audition.
Right.
So I look at them and I'm like, oh my God, they did a great job. I can't figure out who they are. And I'm like, okay, next. But it's not because I want to pass them up. It's just the information isn't there. And that can save your butt. So your point is really, really good. So what are you looking to do future-wise as far as music goes? Is there anything, you know, kind of on your bucket list that you'd like to do?
You know, for me, it's just always been about getting to create for a living. Any kind of accolade that comes in after that is just
icing on the cake, as they say.
Icing on the cake. And it's just so hard. You could have a fantastic year, and the next year there may not be any, you know, many movies that use your kind of music or many artists that were looking for, you know, there's just all kinds of reasons why success doesn't mean success the next year and the next year and the next year.
Yeah. I watched this. Somebody sent me a video today about success, and it was an actor, writer, producer who was talking about, and this probably holds true to you and I, is the first and foremost is never quit.
Mm-hmm.
Never quit. But the other thing I found really interesting, and I'm like, ooh, am I doing it? It made me give pause. But you need to be working harder than anyone else in the room that does what you do. And that's probably the thing that can keep you going.
I have three books on the music business and different things. And I think in all of them, I mentioned my three rules, and that was persistence, and then more persistence.
Oh, I love that. Yep.
There's no substitute for that. Even if you're writing during the day and you're getting in your quota of writing a song or two songs or three songs, when I get home at night, then I'm pitching instead of watching Netflix most of the time.
Yeah, you got to figure out where that song's going so you can pay the rent. I mean, it's a process, and it's the same here. And some days it's a little scary. How did the pandemic affect you? Was that like super hard, or you were able to still push through? Or
it was very hard. I was running a publishing company for a record label, and I lost that job because of the pandemic. And it took a good year.
Oh, wow.
Another staff deal. Regardless of how many credits I had, it's just that people didn't have the money to hire anybody. So,
yeah.
So it's always interesting when something like that happens.
Have you noticed a difference? Because I feel like as on my side, on the filmmaking side, I'm starting to see a difference. Like we're not wearing masks and we're coming to set and we're being, more secure and the work is starting to pick up. And of course, now these strikes have hit. But prior to that, are you seeing a change?
Fortunately, I'm seeing the change, especially in the Christmas genre, because most of those movies are independent films, and those films aren't affected as much as the major films. Last I looked, there was over 200 Christmas movies being made.
Oh, wow. So hopefully there'll be an uptick, actually, in that then. Oh, that's so cool. Yeah. So
it's been good for that reason. Like I said, I have to reach out to all 200 to even get six to say yes, because they don't know you.
So right. And then those that say yes, if they're indie, they could be raising their funds or,
Sure.
Yeah, it's definitely, I could see it's work, but it's a labor of love. It's music. There's nothing better than music in life. So how can people find your music and possibly book you if they want to book you?
I have an interesting situation this year. I've never had this situation before. Usually I would have a staff deal where a publishing company paid me to write for them, and they would get all the publishing off my songs, so they would get 50% of the income.
Oh.
Right now, I have a booking agent, so I get to keep my publishing. And they're booking me for rights and then taking a percentage of that booking, but I still have my publishing. So
that sounds better.
So far, it seems to be better. It's I'll take either situation, anything that's allowed me to do.
Work is work. But okay, so how do we find you? How do filmmakers find you?
So CoreyLeeBarker.com is an easy way. Whenever I send an email, I think you would notice I now have a link full of cleared Christmas songs. And I think there's 200 something of them in there. That makes it a little easier on too, because I don't tell them that you have to go listen to any of this stuff. But if they wanted to, they can click on it and they don't have to download anything unless they wanted it. They can see
the picture. Yeah, I loved that.
Lyric and that kind of thing. So that's made it helpful a little bit.
Yeah.
They can find me on, Facebook or Instagram or any of that kind of stuff.
If your songs are placed in a movie, are you able to use them again later? Are there ever restrictions on that?
No, I've never had a restriction so far. I've got one in a couple movies this year. I've had that happen before. And sometimes it's the same music supervisor that wants it for two of their movies. Because it's not about, look, for instance, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Yeah, yeah.
That's going to be, nobody says, oh, that was in another movie. I don't want that.
Or I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. Everybody puts that
in. It's in a million movies. Is it right for your scene and your movie? And that's all they worry about typically.
Oh, wow. So if we're exploring your catalog and we find an artist whose stuff we love, but we wanted a new song, are those things you're able to facilitate?
Oh, we love that. We love getting someone to tell. For instance, there's a movie called The Perfect Christmas Pairing this year, and we actually wrote a song called A Perfect Christmas Pairing. Sometimes they don't ask us. We do it anyway and just hoping that they'll use it.
Oh, that's cool. That is cool. I was just wondering, how does that work? But okay, that's good to know. So
We love it when you say, please give us a song with this verbiage in it or this title or something to do with shopping. Any specifics you could tell the songwriter makes their job much easier to either write a new one or find one they already have.
Yeah. Yeah. I always wonder, because, so far in my career, I've had to, I'm fortunate for a long time. I had a songwriter in my family, which I don't anymore. She's moved on to other things, but I haven't had that experience where I can actually say, I want this, I want that. I'll go and listen and find music. And, I'm excited. I'm really excited about doing a Christmas film or something that's not, I usually kill people in my movies. So it's kind of nice not to do that, I'm thinking, but I'm very excited to be able to like be, oh, I love this person's voice, or I want to come up with this kind of song. And I'm thinking about that for Rekindled, my Christmas film, which is how I met you. So we'll see. We'll see. I mean, obviously I can't do that until we do get our investor, and everyone on there is union. So I kind of am writing out the strike, but.
And I will tell you, it's not unheard of. There are other music supervisors that like to write for their own films. I've had some that call me and we have sessions and that kind of thing. And we put together songs that are, because nobody knows the script as much as a music supervisor or the writer.
That's true.
And they say, I have this idea, you know, do you have a session open in the next couple of weeks or whatever? And we lock it in and we'll Zoom.
That's awesome. So, God, I would love it if I could end up doing that. I know on my film, Rekindled, one of the stars, she's a Tony winner. And I think she's Grammy nominated or something, right? That. And I'm like, ooh, I wonder if we could like get her. She's the star. The movie's about her, right? I'm like, what if we could get her to sing and I could pair her with you? You know, like I'm just dreaming of all these options now. But, you know, obviously we got to make it happen. But
yeah. You know what else you can do sometimes? I had a movie earlier this year. I haven't seen it yet, but the artist, she learned the song that I'd sent and then she sang it live on the movie. It was just part of the movie. She played guitar sitting on a bench in a certain scene.
Yeah.
Live instead of playing the recording of the song. And I thought that was interesting.
I have the gentleman, because of the strike, I can't really say who he is, but he's attached. He has released multiple albums, including, I think he told me, 11 Christmas albums over the course of his career, but they were all adult Christmas songs. I don't know how to put that, but he's a fantastic musician and, you know, he does a little blues. And I was like, oh my God, I plan on having him sing live during, there's a couple events in the film. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about that too, what you just said. I'm like, ooh, but for him, because then the family could, you know, could be something like a traditional vibe going on. Yeah. But yeah, that would be so cool. I'm hoping we'll get there. But so you have books out too. For your books, they're on the music industry.
Yes, there's one. Let's see. The first one was just about the music, right? Basically about Nashville, writing for artists.
Oh, cool.
In Nashville. And the series is called A Hit Happens, HIT.
I love that. Oh my God, that's great.
So the second one was 101 Ways to Get Your Songs Recorded. And then the one from last year was Writing for Sync. So that's more in your world.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's so cool. And they can find those probably on Amazon or something.
Yeah, you can go to Amazon.com and type in Corey Lee Barker books and they'll all pop up.
Oh, that's awesome. That is so cool. Well, you have been so fun to talk to and I can't wait to like work with you. But I want to wrap this up by doing our 5 for 5 goofy questions.
Oh, here we go.
Okay. All right. So the first question, what's your favorite food?
It's a 3-way tie between pizza, steak, and chicken fajita nachos.
It depends on the day of the week or yeah.
All three if I can. My wife did that for my birthday one time.
Oh my God. I love it. That's so funny. What is something not music related, but something that inspires you or motivates you as a person?
Oh, I would say faith.
Faith. That's beautiful. Okay. What is something that you have always dreamed of doing, not music related, but you haven't done yet, a bucket list kind of thing?
Oh, I would say a sitcom. Being the village idiot would be so much fun.
Are you serious? Like acting in one?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I did a lot of acting early on, but I got so involved and I didn't have time for it. And
God, that's awesome.
Yeah. Being silly. I absolutely love that. I hate being serious.
Oh my gosh. That's cool. I love that. Oh my gosh. Okay. Number 4. This might be hard for you. I don't know. But what is your favorite song to sing at the top of your lungs when you're driving in the car and no one's looking?
Oh my gosh. I wouldn't even know.
I know.
One of my favorite songs of all time was The Dance by Garth Brooks, just because of what it said. But that's not one you really sing at the top of your lungs.
No, that's a sentimental.
Maybe play that funky music, White Boy, if the mood is right. I'm not sure.
There you go. Funky music. Yeah, that's a good one. I love it. Okay, this one is the last one. And this one is really hard for filmmakers. What is your favorite movie?
That's a very, very hard.
It is. There's so many. What's a movie you've watched like more than 10 times?
So Star Wars dominated my childhood. That whole from an imagination standpoint. Dumb and Dumber just made me laugh beyond belief. So I love silly stuff. And for some reason, every time Unnecessary Roughness came on, I couldn't turn it off.
Oh, that's funny.
Another comedy as well. So. But on any day, the answer is probably different on any given day. There's so many great films out there, so many great filmmakers.
There are. You know, people like me even like the bad ones because I just sometimes you can't look away. You're just like, no, they didn't. No, no, right? But they're good. It's all good. So is there any last things you might want to share for anyone listening?
Just want to encourage everybody to keep going because sometimes it just takes forever to get that big break. And it took me 20 years to figure out that I was Christmas Corey. And after I embraced it, they told me that I'm having a good time running with it. So
yeah, it's a perfect thing to run with. It's beautiful. Well, you've been a delight. You've been awesome. And I hope you have a great day, but I also hope you come back and talk to me anytime.
Anytime. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Today's show is sponsored by Gym Kitty, helping women on their health and wellness journey by providing high quality, organically sourced vitamins and supplements. Visit them today at www.gymkitty.net. You've been listening to Movie Making with Renell Golden. Be sure to come back for our next episode where we bring you the people who make movies you love. Got a topic about filmmaking you want to hear on our podcast? Send us an email at moviemakingpodcast@gmail.com. Thanks for listening.
This podcast has been sponsored by Samara Entertainment.